Every 6 months or a year, a mysterious process called the performance reviews determines many people's bonuses, stock awards, and promotions. Do you ever wonder what happens behind those closed doors? Are you curious what advantages you will have if you understand how the system works? Let's dive right in. First of all, you need to know why companies do performance reviews. Let's assume for a moment that we have a fishing company. We have 4 employees, and by the end of the month, we counted how much fish each of them got. Emily got 100 pounds of shrimp. Jack, on the other hand, only got 20 pounds. Lisa got 50 pounds of shrimp, a giant octopus, and also a bluefin tuna by convincing some other fishermen to join forces and help. Sebastian, however, did not like water at all and didn't end up catching anything. We look at the results and we start to think how we can maximize our success next month. Emily was obviously doing something right. How do we make sure she continues to do that? Jack needed to improve. And we already knew what he was doing wrong. How do we make sure he internalizes he needs to put in some efforts here? Lisa achieved a whole different level of success. Moving forward, how do we allow her to just focus on octopus and bluefin tuna instead of shrimp? Sebastian really struggled with being a fisherman. What do we do to let him know that this may not be a good fit? To solve these problems, we introduced rewards and promotions. Rewards give everyone quantifiable measure of success. High rewards amplify good behaviors and make sure employees keep doing what's working well. Low rewards help land a strong message that the employee needs to improve or rethink whether this is a great job. Promotions and levels help make a clear distinction that there are different expectations for different employees. Some are asked to just focus on getting shrimp, while others may be expected to focus on more challenging objectives such as leading a crew to catch bigger fish, which requires experience. These methodologies are what ended up being called the performance reviews, which is simply a process that tries to maximize each employee's success. With that understanding of what performance reviews are, now let's talk about how it works. Depending on the company, they usually kick off the performance review cycles every 6 months or a year. And that typically results in the busiest month for people managers. The first thing managers need to do is data collection. Managers need to gather as much information as possible about the output of each direct report. Typically, this is done through 3 channels. First, each employee would write up a self-review, which describes from their own perspective what they had achieved. Secondly, managers will gather peer feedback for each direct report from people they work with. This can help cover blind spots and also keep people honest. Lastly, managers will have their own observations as well, which will also need to get captured. Managers will then look at all the data points coming from these 3 channels above and do some fact-checking. There might be conflicting statements from different people. There could be ambiguous data points about how much impact was achieved. Managers need to do their best to reconcile all the information and fill gaps. This can take a lot of time. But without doing this rigorously, managers can risk misrepresenting their direct report's performances. Once all the facts are there, managers will then need to do some assessments. Typically, there are 2 things managers need to evaluate here. 1, how does the employee's performance compare with what's expected of their current level? This evaluation will determine the amount of rewards they receive. 2, how does the employee's performance compare with what's expected of the next level? This evaluation will determine whether the employee is ready for promotion. This is why it's very important for you to clearly understand the different levels and expectations, because then you can be deliberate about practicing and using skills required at the next level. And that can help demonstrate your readiness for promotion. I have attached a link to my previous video, which gave an overview of the key expectations at each level that might be helpful to you. I will also make a video within the next couple of weeks specifically talking about how you should work with your manager to approach your promotion. Please remember to subscribe if you don't want to miss it. Now that the managers have done their evaluations, they will go into the next step, which is often called calibrations. Many people think calibrations are about comparing employees with each other and calibrating their performances. That's not quite right. At its core, calibrations are more about calibrating the managers, because their evaluations of employees' performances could be biased or inconsistent. This is why people invented the calibration process, to help ensure the company is holding a consistent bar and rewarding people as fairly as possible. During calibrations, a group of managers whose direct reports are comparable will get into a room and review their evaluations of employees with each other. Comparable usually means people at the same level, doing similar work. For example, it would be difficult to conclude fairness between a data scientist and a software engineer, or even between a software engineer who works on infrastructure versus one that works on consumer products. Managers will take turns to present the packets that captured each employee's performance and their evaluations. Other managers will ask questions and share their feedback on whether or not they think the evaluation is fair. When there are ambiguous cases, the managers will cross-examine different employees' packets to make sure they are using a consistent bar. For example, they can look at two employees that are getting the same rewards and ask the group whether they all agree their contributions are indeed similar. Or they can look at two employees who are getting different rewards and ask the group to validate whether they indeed see a significant difference between them that justifies the gap in rewards. After that, managers will also discuss promotion candidates, and they will share feedback with each other on whether they believe the person is indeed ready or if they see any risks. Companies want to avoid prematurely promoting employees, because once they are promoted, they will start getting held against the next level's expectations. And if they can't meet that in a sustainable way, they will start to struggle and start to get low rewards, which can demotivate them and send them into a downward spiral that can damage their whole career. Once promotions are discussed, it will conclude the calibration session, and managers will submit their final evaluations, typically for HR and senior leadership team to review. This review makes sure outliers are closely examined and statistical anomalies are properly explained. For example, it's very unlikely for an organization of hundreds of people to all be exceeding their expectations at the same time. So when that happens, questions will be raised, and the leader of the organization needs to have very good answers. In some companies, a certain statistical distribution is strictly enforced at organization or team level to avoid spending too much time on debating the anomalies. Once the final reviews are done, managers will start to schedule one-on-one discussions with each direct report to reveal results and deliver feedback, which concludes the performance review cycle. Now that you know how it works, what can you do to take advantage of that knowledge? There is a lot you can do to help with data collection. First, make sure your self-review is as complete as possible. You want to support your statements with clear data points to help quantify your impact. You also want to capture how you did against next level's expectations. Many companies have a documentation or wiki page explaining the detailed expectations for each level, and you should describe how you did with that lens. Many people don't know this trick, but it really helps make the promotion eligibility discussion a lot easier. I will have a future video specifically talking about how to approach promotions, so don't forget to subscribe if you're interested. Another tip that I found useful was to write up your self-review ahead of time and share it with your manager earlier than the deadline. This is because once the performance review cycle officially starts, your manager will be extremely busy and won't have as much time to fine-tune the details with you. But if you shared your self-review early, your manager might be able to give you some feedback to help refine it so that your performance can be better represented during the calibrations. Outside of self-review, peer feedback and manager's observations are also important sources of inputs. What you can do here is to collect peer feedback and manager feedback frequently and proactively outside of the performance review cycles so that you can react to them and potentially make improvements sooner, which can change what their feedback looks like in the official process. Lastly, when you receive the final results, remember that the whole purpose of performance review process is to help maximize your success moving forward. Whether the result is good or bad, you need to focus on the underlying message that your manager is trying to deliver. Maybe it's about keep doing something you did well, or maybe there's some constructive feedback for areas to improve. Make sure you clearly understand what that is, instead of only focusing on the rating or rewards, which don't help you grow. I would love to hear from each of you what's the most valuable feedback that you have ever received. Please comment below and let me know. Alright, now you understand how this mysterious process works. I hope you find it useful. See you next time.